one of the main reasons people gravitate towards live is because of this flexibility that we can have with audio. So what we're going to be doing is referred to as warping audio. And what we have to do is basically give the software some information about this audio file, which will allow us to change its time and its pitch independently of each other. So there was a time when pitch and time were married. When people were matching records together, let's say if you're a DJ and you have one record that's at one BPM and then another that's at a slightly different BPM, you're either gonna have to slow down or speed up one of them so that they begin to match. And through that process, you're also either raising the pitch or lowering the pitch. As you speed something up, the pitch raises, and as you slow something down, the pitch lowers. So with digital tools like live and warping, we're able to do those things completely independently. So we could completely change the tempo of something without changing its pitch whatsoever. And conversely, we could very dramatically change the pitch without actually changing the timing of the file. Really powerful, and it's really fun, and it's very, very creative as well. So here in this new audio track, I have a breakbeat. I'm just gonna play this so you can hear it. So as this is happening, I'm also going to launch this hi-hat pattern, and it should feel dramatically off from each other. That's because this breakbeat file isn't warped yet. We haven't set it to a grid, so we can't really stretch or compress or do anything to this file until we go ahead and warp it. So let's begin that process here. To start off with, we need to identify what the original tempo of this file is. So this was recorded in the 60s or the 70s, so they probably weren't playing to a metronome, so it's gonna have some natural human looseness to it, but we can get really close. So I'm gonna press play here, and then as that's happening, I'm gonna start tapping out the tempo just by hovering over this tap icon here and tapping on my trackpad. And it's gonna interpolate through all of these taps what is the BPM of this file. So here I go. It says I'm at 95.28. So I'm just gonna round down to 95, press enter, and now I've identified the original tempo or the general tempo of this file. Next thing I need to do is turn the warp function on. So it's down here in the sample properties box. Just hit warp, and then immediately you see a grid pop up. So I'm gonna turn the metronome on and press play. Still very off. So we need to give the software a little bit more information. Where are the downbeats? Where's beat two? Where's beat three? So on and so forth. So then we can do this manipulation with it. Quickly, I'm gonna turn the metronome off. So the first order of business is to identify the first downbeat. I'm gonna press play, and I have a strong suspicion that it's this first transients here. 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4. Right, so you can count it until you decide, okay, this is the downbeat, right? So I'm gonna zoom in here. So I used the word transients before, so let's just talk about what that means. As I zoom in, you can see there are these tiny little white triangles above the peaks of the waveform. And if I hover over them, I get this sort of gray tab that becomes visible to me. So what these are transient markers. And the transient is the definitive beginning of any sound. So if it's a drum, it's a stick hitting the skin. If it's a vocalist, it's the beginning of a syllable coming out of their mouth. And these are extremely useful places to know where they are in this audio file, because it's saying, here is what we think is a transient. I also listened with my ears, and I know that this is the downbeat. I'm going to place what is referred to as a warp marker. And I like to think of them as anchors, saying I'm anchoring this in a very specific place. So if I hover over it, I'm getting this temporary warp marker. And if I double click on it, it turns yellow, and it becomes a permanent warp marker. So I'm going to zoom out. But according to this grid, this downbeat is happening sometime after the second beat of measure one, but my ears and my brain tell me that it's actually the first beat of measure one. So while hovering over this permanent warp marker, I'm gonna right-click on my computer and I get this menu. So this is what we are looking for. We wanna set 1.1.1 here, meaning that I wanna set measure one, beat one, tick one, this is the beginning of this file. I choose this, and then you can see the grid immediately moves over, and now this is lined up. So let's press play with the metronome on again and see where we're at. So they're now starting at the same point, but they're not synced up. So we have to do a little bit more work here. If I right-click on this again, the menu will give me a number of options. I can warp it from here. I can warp from here starting at 95 BPM, which is the tempo that I dictated. I can do this straight. There's a number of options when it comes to warping, and each of these behaves a little bit differently. But for the purposes of our course, we're going to warp from here starting at the tempo that we have dictated. So I'm going to select start at 95.5. And here we go. Let's try again and see where we're at. Okay, we're very, very close to being lined up. I can see that the end of this file is moving into the first half of bar 5, and I just want it to loop immediately. So I'm going to take the stop markers, move them over to the end of measure 4, beginning of measure 5 here. I'm going to turn loop on and move the start marker over here. So when I play this, I should get a 4-bar loop that loops and is in time with the metronome. All right, we're very, very close now. So initially I had told you that this file probably wasn't recorded to a metronome in the first place. So me trying to superimpose a metronome on top of it is getting really close, but it's not perfect. So I'm going to just move some of these events that need a little bit more attention, maybe some snares that are not hitting right on beat 2, and move them directly to beat 2. So I know that it was measure 3 and 4. So I'm going to zoom in here on measure 3. So here's the snare. Here's the beginning of measure 3. Here's beat 1. And here's beat 2. So you can see, as I zoom in here, this transient marker is not lined up with beat 2, which is where it optimally should be. So I'm going to create a permanent warp marker here. So just watch me do this. As I pull this around, this entire file is moving, which is not what I want. I just want to move this one event. So I just did Apple Z to undo what I just did. So in order to make sure that only this moves, I need to create anchors on either side. So I'm going to create permanent warp markers on the nearest transients, and then I'll grab this one, and you can see I'm now independently moving this in between those other anchors that I've created. Let's go ahead and do that in a few other places here. Keep this one moving beat 4 of measure 3. And so what I'm seeing is that a lot of these are just slightly delayed. So perhaps if I grab this one and move it all over, that we're lined up a bit more. It looks like that is the case. So this is slightly more of a surgical way to get into warping and make sure everything's lined up. And some files will be very easy to warp, and others will be more challenging, will be a little bit more attention, depending on where they came from. So let's listen one more time and hear what's going on. All right, I'm feeling really good about that. So I could go further, I could do more, I could do less. It's really up to you. You just follow your ears there. Let's move back over to the sample property box here and talk about warping algorithms. So if I click on this icon here, I get a drop-down menu that's giving me a number of options. So the algorithm is how Live analyzes and processes this file. And not all the files are the same, so there's a number of warping algorithms. Percussive files are dealt in one way. Textural files like chords or guitar accompaniment would be processed in another way. So in order for Ableton to do its very best job at warping and processing your audio, you need to identify the proper algorithm for your file. So you can see I have a number of options. I have beats, tones, textures, repitch, complex, and complex pro. beats would be for a rhythmic file. And this is not just restricted to drums. Let's say you have some very percussive singing or scatting or beatboxing. You're going to want to choose beats, regardless of the fact that it's coming out of somebody's mouth. Tones is going to be for a monophonic file or something that's just having one note play at a time. Perhaps this is like a saxophone, or really anything that's just one note playing. Textures is going to be for polyphony, which is more than one note playing at a single time. So chord accompaniments, pads, something that has a little bit more going on. Repitch is going to remarry pitch and time. So as we adjust pitch, time will also be adjusted. And then we have Complex and Complex Pro. These are for files that maybe aren't just so straightforward, right? And they're a little bit more taxing on your CPU, and Pro is the more taxing of the two. But really, they're just kind of variations of the same thing. So sometimes you can just switch between the two and see which one sounds better. And that's really what matters, is what sounds the best, right? So I could go through and choose beats, give it a listen. If it's not really up to snuff, I can always try Complex or perhaps some of these other algorithms. And there's much more under the surface that we're not addressing right now, which I really encourage you to investigate, because warping can be a super creative process as well, if you want it to be. So now I've set this to beats, and I've got all of my audio warped and snapped to the grid, and it's playing in time. So let's add some chords to some of these audio ideas and just make sure that we're all lined up. Feeling really good about this. So before I move on, I just want to show you a really creative approach to messing with warping. So I'm just nailing down these downbeats, and I'm actually going to remove the other warp markers. So now I only have them on the beginning of measures 1, 2, 3, and 4. So I'm going to add them on beat 4 here and then just pull back so that I've smushed all of the audio into the beginning part of this measure, and then it's going to sound very odd and digitized as well. But this would be a creative application of the tool. So it's strange, but it's actually really cool. Don't think of this as a utility purpose. It absolutely can be, but it can also be very, very creative. And now you have the basic fundamental tools of how to warp in Ableton. You need to identify the original BPM of the file. You need to pin certain places, like a downbeat, to a grid, truncate the file so that it's matching a certain amount of measures, and then you're off to the races. From here, we can do a lot. Like transposition, I'm gonna now transpose this file down. Transpose it up. And we're staying right in time there.